I'd say a football stadium with no one in it is a bit like a graveyard, except that it would be a bit of an insult to some of the more exciting cemeteries in London. It's not exactly spooky, but some of the echoes of glory days gone by, some of the memories still seem to be in the air. Sentimental fool, if you will, but sometimes when I was the last person there on a late night, I might just get to thinking about what brought me here and some of the memories along the way. Like any story, this one has a beginning, a middle, and an end, but not necessarily in that order. But I suppose any investigation needs to start at the beginning, and for me, this is where it all started. There's something very special about the East End. And for me, what's special is the love of football. I lived in Bonham Road, Dagenham, and the area had enough footballers to fill the first division team. The Allen family, Ken Brown, Dickie Walker, the Coneys, and Greavesy and Martin Peters, they lived just up the road. I went to school here. We'll hear about what they had to say about me later. As a kid, this was my real love, right from the word go. That's just where we used to play, right outside the house in Bonham Road, with the lampposts doubling as floodlights and goalposts. That's some pie and mash after the game. The Brazilians might have their Copacabana beach, but we've got our East End streets. And I'm very happy about it. I haven't changed a bit. That's what I used to look like in those days. And this is where we used to live. The house hasn't changed much either, apart from the car in the front garden. I used to like wearing a hat, and that's where I got it from. That's my dad, Fred, and that's my mum, Myrtle.
He was born in number 313 Valens Avenue, my mother's house. Fred was in the forces, and I lived there with my parents. There's my father. He was a professional runner and footballer.
This is my dad's pub. We own a few of them now. A lot of them in, I suppose you'd say, posh places like Berkshire and Oxfordshire. This is my dad, Fred. He likes to show a bit of paternal pride, Fred.
He always went out with a ball in his pocket. Never go out without one. He'd be over the park every evening, every day, in the street. Was football, or any sort of sport actually, but football mostly. The tennis ball he stopped. If he went in for billiards, he'd play billiards, he'd play it properly, he'd go over there with his granddad. Having a little dock, didn't matter where he'd done, he had to do it properly. He had to be right, which has served him later in life. It's obvious, isn't it?
And down the other end of the bar are three of my top mates. We had some special times together.
We all used to meet at Terry's house. That was the meeting place. And we'd change in his house, we'd go over there, and we'd play till it was too dark to see the ball. And really, he looked a man playing with the boys.
For a young boy, he had tremendous attitude to the game. I mean, even at 16, I think he knew he had weaknesses. And, I mean, he wasn't particularly quick, really, was he?
No, that's
some
right.
Of the standards.
And also,
and I can remember him going over the park and practising, just sprinting, morning after morning. As I say, even on a Sunday, after he's played in the first team on a Saturday, just to improve his performance. And that's why he's been successful today.
And Terry used to hate to lose. I mean, we've all played games with Terry. I mean, the only game that I could get near Terry was tennis. And I was quite a good tennis player. And I'd be playing Terry at Valence Park in the summer, and he'd call out. Can he be out? And Billy had played squash with him, wouldn't he? And he was a good squash player.
He's a competitive natured person, and that's...
He didn't used to like losing at cards.
No.
And Fred used to cheat anyway, you see, so he used to look after the pair of us, and, but we, that's where, from Dagenham, it all stemmed from.
At Lymington School, the team was looked after and encouraged by a very special teacher, Mr. George Jackson.
He lived only for football. He was very keen. He would do whatever you told him, and then he'd go outside and practice it 10 times. He was a natural leader, you know, and in whatever field you care to think. I mean, sport, academic work. He was at the top in both. After I moved on to another school, there was the usual collection around the whole school on a presentation. But that wasn't good enough for Terry. Terry wanted this team, you know, was something special, and Terry wanted them to do something. And they collected some money, and they brought a number of gifts. One of the things that Terry gave me that I've still got is a watch. So, I'll show it to you if you like. And it still works.
It was about this time that I started to get the odd mention in the local paper.
Venables netted twice and given a lot of room to work. Sent a steady stream of accurate passes down the centre and to the wings. Dagenham boys hit South East Essex for 13. Dagenham's great strength, as usual, stemmed from the impeccable display of Terry Venables. His ball control, through passes and tackling, stamped him as a player years in advance of almost everyone else. Clark Cup for Dagenham boys. Venables in line for a cap on this form. Dagenham right half and captain Terry Venables gave a hard-working display, and besides helping the defence whenever he was needed, found the net 3 times. If he continued to give this type of display, then the Lymington boy seems well on the way to an international cap next season. No trouble for boys. Skipper Terry Venables was the schemer of the Dagenham team, and gave them the lead after 5 minutes.
And even...
Venables wins cross-country.
Oh, the other kids must have been slow.
As a schoolboy, he was a very gifted player. Good individual skill. He was a character. He liked a joke, but I mean, he was a deep thinking boy as well, and very, very good personality.
After the London trials, where I first met Alan, I progressed to play for the county, and then I received my first England schoolboy cap. Perhaps my proudest moment.
The first time I met Terry was when he was 14 years of age, and the chairman of West Ham United, Reg Pratt, said to me, Malcolm, who are the best players in the East End, you know, the East End of London? So I said, we've got two already. We've got John Carter and we've got Bobby Moore. But the other player is a boy called Terry Venables. And the difference between players with me are, even at that age, are the players who play instinctively and run with the ball and they're good athletes, and the player who plays with a certain amount of awareness and imagination. And Bobby Moore and Johnny Cartwright and Terry Venables were those three of those type of players. And what Terry Venables had, he had great vision and lots of imagination.
But it was Chelsea with their youth policy and not Malcolm's West Ham which attracted me there, and Chief Scout Jimmy Thompson came to play an increasing part in my life.
We bought Terry a bag for Christmas, and it was a lovely bag, you know. And it was standing in the passageway down there, you know, it's a very small passageway. And Jimmy Thompson came along this particular day, and he said, whose bike is that out there? So he said, Terry's. He said, well, that's no good, he said. Not for footballers' legs. He said, it develops the wrong muscles. And from that day on, Terry never rode that bike again. It was put out in the shed, and it was there for a few years until we gave it away.
I don't think I missed that bike too much, but I certainly would have missed my football.
Tackle! Shoot! Go on, tackle him! Good shoot!
He had to do as he was told. His mother said do it, he had to do it. If he was naughty, he stayed in his room. That's the worst punishment you could give him, because you could hear the kids playing in the street. That was the worst punishment you could give Terry.
They were great days down Bonham Road, and I'm happy to go back any time. But the cars in the street make playing football a lot more difficult now, and the lure of the telly, well, that's pretty strong, isn't it? They have changed some of the streets too, given some of them funny names. But some things never change.
Oh, Come on, Fred, hurry up, I'm starving.
Like my eternal love for this stuff.
You know, you've got a good status. Back to Dagenham, mate.
Me and Fred with good old pie and mash, and especially the liquor.
Limington, in Dagenham, Limington Secondary School.
When did you leave school?
Last summer.
And how old are you now?
16.
The football is our whole life?
Yes.
And you wanted to go on being our whole life?
Yes.
That's me. And if that's hard for you to believe, I find it practically impossible to grasp that it was over 30 years ago. Every day I used to make that journey across town to Stamford Bridge. But it was a journey I would have made for nothing, let alone the £6 a week we earned in those days. I suppose you could say that my time at Chelsea was the happiest I've ever had. Just looking around there now, it brings the memories flooding back, the place, the game, and most of all, the people. And of course, it wasn't a bad team either.
Up went Osgood and Jack Charlton together. A flick to Graham, his shot rebounded to Tambling. Goal to Chelsea.
There we was with Barry Bridges, Tambling, Harrison, Jimmy, all the stars, and we'd be on the terraces, and the first day we got there, Harry, I forget his second name, but he was the old groundsman. He said, "Which one of you is Venables?" And Terry said, "That's me." He said, "I've got a right job for you." He said, "Up in the main stand," he said. And there, he said, Terry, because they sorted him out, you see, and there we're all with our brooms, and there's Tambling and Bridges and Pete Burnett here, and there's Terry up in the far court laughing his head off.
The youth team I joined was obviously destined for big things. We won the Youth Cup 2 years running, and Chelsea gave me the chance to tour Europe for the first time and wear another silly hat. And at just 17, I made it into the first team. I'll always feel like I owe Chelsea a debt. But don't say it too loud, otherwise knowing Ken Bates, he might make me pay it. But where have those days gone? And where are those faces? We were always hanging around the cafes, after training, talking football for hours and hours. Now that's what we looked like then. And now look, we haven't changed at all, have we? Bobby and Barry, still inseparable. Alan, Ken, George and John. Talk about the Magnificent Seven.
I felt that even we had a sort of own mates, like you were with Bob and I was with Alan and George and so forth. But I never had such a good relationship with the lot. It was like a very strong, even though we weren't sort of going out together too much, we were very sort of close, everyone was so close. That was unreal, really, to a lot of ways.
Yeah, we all thought it was a good idea, didn't we, to start a tail-end business. You see, because you knew so many showbiz people used to come to the games, but they didn't pay their bills. Norman Wisdom, who wouldn't pay his bill?
I never used to want to admit that we made Norman Wisdom suits.
We never got the contract for the hat, but we used to make his suits. They said, not them little funny ones. I said, no, it's ones that he normally wears.
So we get back to the hotel, and it's Christmas, and there's a big doing in the hotel, right? So there's this band there playing away, and they're in the dinner dance. So one of the lads goes up to the band leader and says, Terry Venables, you know, is here with the Chelsea team. We're staying in, you know, in preparation for the game at Christmas. So he says, he's a very good singer, he's made a record with Joe Loss. So we all sort of like give Terry a big hand to get him sing. And I always remember he starts singing, sleigh bells ringing,
skanging across the floor.
Anyway, carried on with the song. All of a sudden somebody says, here's the dog. So Tommy's walking through the hotel, so everybody disappears up to the rooms. He goes into the ballroom, Terry's in full flow with a knife.
And you all disappeared.
And we all disappeared. And we all went up to our bedrooms, and the doc caught Terry full flow on the stage. Never forget. It's very, very funny.
All the lads were behind me, 20%.
I don't know what the outcome is.
there was an act on, a chappy doing a miming act. And Terry was fascinated. So when this chappy came off the stage, Terry ran up to him and started asking him questions. And he told him the way he'd learnt was by looking in the mirror, speaking in the mirror, then learning to sing in the mirror, and all that, you know. And Terry spent hours doing that. And he used to go for our local club and get up on the stage and do a miming act. And occasionally give a song, but most of the miming. And he was really good, there was no doubt about it.
He was a great mimic, Terry. He was just an absolute unbelievable character. Great mimic, singer, lover. You know what I mean? So we got chased a few times.
The thing about Terry, he was very good ad-libbing. He was very good at joking. What I'm trying to say is if someone said something to him quick, he would always get a response. And I always felt, looking back to when Tom Dockey was in charge, Tom didn't like that. He liked saying things to people, but if anybody chipped back, he didn't really feel at home in that sort of atmosphere. And Terry was very good at that. So it never worried Terry about people giving him a stick. And it still doesn't.
I met Terry Venables, I was 15 years old. I'm 44 now, I don't look it, but I was working at a music publishing company called Mills Music. I was a packer there, office boy packer. With Elton John. Elton John and I worked together. We were both the office boys there. Terry used to come in those days, he played for Chelsea. And in those days, Terry Venables would come in every day after training, or maybe not every day, maybe three, 4 days, or times a week. He would come in with Johnny Hollins and Georgie Graham and Alan Harris and Ronnie Harris. They would go and visit one of my bosses there, Tony Hiller. So we'd come and they would hear a new song. They would also meet other stars, those that Adam Faith would come in and Cliff Richards. There was a lot of people around for them to see. Also, Terry used to make, because Terry, I don't know if you know this, but Terry's got a great singing voice. I mean, Terry could have actually been, if he chose to have been, a professional singer.
Well, why do you want to make those eyes at me for? If they don't mean what they say, they make me glad, they make me sad, they make me want a lot of things that I've never had. You're fooling around.
It's very easy to talk about Terry Venables, and I first met Venners when he was playing in a great Chelsea side. I still played football in those days, and I used to go training with Chelsea a couple of days a week, and believe it or not, Venners and I looked very much alike. We were rather like brothers. And then they went up to play Tranmere Rovers in the Cup, and as I say, from a distance, we really did look very much alike. And my late father-in-law was in the grandstands at Prenton Park up at Tranmere, and Chelsea ran out, and his eyes weren't all that good, I must add, and he went, "Jesus Christ, Chelsea signed our Jimmy."
But I was always interested in doing more with my time. The afternoons weren't just for playing snooker. It was then where I met a journalist who made me realise there was a bigger world out there, as well as football.
All these players of that Chelsea time, which when they were becoming stars, they were getting offered little articles, or £100 or £2,000 for a Sunday paper article. Now they would then get a ghost and an agent, you see, and they might end up with 40-50% of this money. And as I discovered that quite a few of them, in fact most of them, were much more intelligent, certainly much more intelligent than the press that was coming to interview them. Yeah. I said, why don't you write your own articles? And then you would keep 100%. I remember Peter Osgood saying, I couldn't sit still that long. I couldn't sit, keep my bum in a chair that long. It'd be so boring. Terry was different. He had already started going to coaching. You know, FA type things and doing other things, and he had invested in a tailor's shop in Old Compton Street, Soho. He turned up with this typed short story. Typed. And he said, what do you think of that? I'm a bit shy about showing you, but, you know, sure, what do you think of this? So I read it, and I said, well, it's quite incredible. How did you do this? He said, well, after what you said, and I'd watched you type, and it seemed easy enough, you just tap your fingers into the thing. I went and bought a typewriter. And I thought I'd write this short story about ticket types and things. I said, well, it's amazing. It's one of the best pastiche versions of Damon Runyon. That sort of colourful demi-monde, you know, raffish and sporting chaps and spibs and such. He'd never heard of Damon Runyon. And then I discovered that, he'd never actually read a book the whole way through. Which was a point of honour, because the school teacher had said to him at 12, when he turned in this essay, what am I going to be when I grow up? I am going to play professional football. Stop. Everybody else writes a 3-page essay. And the teacher had said to him, after really being very, you know, sarcastic school teacher model, putting them down, He said, seriously, there's only one in a million gets to be a professional footballer of all the boys in England. And he said, well, that's me. I am the one in a million. And that was 12.
For that escape, Chelsea thanked their lucky stars. A pass found Venables.
Meanwhile, on the field, things were going pretty well, too.
Sprake did well to save.
The amount of talent there was amongst the youngsters at Chelsea was unbelievable. And, you know, for a coach, it was a dream. And Terry was the brightest jewel of the lot. He obviously loved football. He's your midfield general. You know, he'll get hold of the ball off your defence and he'll get your attack organised and get you going, get you functioning as a team. And like that type of player, he would always want the ball, which is an important asset in a team, because if things are going wrong, you know, people don't want the ball. They'll run away from it. But Terry always wanted the ball, and so he was always going to be a very good midfield general.
And the Chelsea side was a great one to be general of. We were well up in the league, and in both 65 and 66, reached the Cup semi-final.
By beating Tambling, a goal-scoring chance.
And he was driving along one day, and it came over the radio that he'd been picked to play for England. And he said, I've got to go and tell my mum. We drove up to his mum's kef, and we got in the kef, he said, I've been picked to play him. And he said, I can't believe it. I said, you're in.
England versus Belgium. England nearest the camera.
Playing for England at full level completed a unique set for me. Caps at all levels and a record that can't be beaten.
The free kick spells danger to Belgium. Venables to Greaves. Jimmy tries hard, but it's just wide. England plug away for the equaliser. Centre forward Fred Pickering finds the net. England see a chance now. The inside left, Terry Venables to Hinton. His cross is deflected by Verbeest. Goal.
My two full caps remain a high point for me as a senior player.
Good sporting game.
So although things were going well for me at Chelsea, this man, the manager, Tommy Docherty, was bringing some tension to bear on the team, let alone me.
He lacked patience, because if we said we was on a par with Leeds, Don Revie kept the team together. He broke the team up, and I think that's the one thing, if you said was lacking, yes. I think was patience.
I would say at that time, it was his first job, he was only new in the job. Yeah. At the end of the day, it was results that spotted that team. In my opinion, it was results.
I mean, Cookie was brilliant in his own right. But, I mean, to try to play Terry's role, you know, there's no sort of similarities at all.
Why do you think there was clashes between Terry and Docherty?
Because
Terry knew more about the bloody game than Tommy Docherty did. Of course he did, at the age. I think he was in too much of a hurry to succeed. He almost saw us reach the peak, and we just failed in the last furlong. We just failed. And what he thought was, right, let's change it all.
I think looking back, if we just quickly go back on us, I think whether it was a fluke, or whether if we come through that thing together and something happened, the blend that we had at Chelsea was it might have been fluky, but it was right. I mean, it was you two that always threatened the back of people. We had people that wanted to hit you early, and as Bob was saying, that suited that. We had good defenders, people that could play, and it was freaky, really. It all went together. But that had come from 15. You was from 15, we were 15, and we're a bit behind you, but it sort of come and we grew together. And that's the best way if you can do it, because you've grown, you've got a great feeling for the club. It's more than a pound note, really. It's a feeling.
But the much-publicised row over the Blackpool night out, when a group of players were sent home, me included, for breaking a curfew, was the public side of increasing private tension. Docherty decided to break up the team. And after some typical newspaper talk, I was on my way to Tottenham and away from Stamford Bridge. And I've got to tell you, it's no exaggeration to say that in the early months, I missed Chelsea bitterly. I've still got that autograph book I had as a lad, with all the names of the Spurs team of the 50s, all proudly inside. Somewhere, I even signed it, T. Venables, Spurs manager. And that was at the age of 10. But when I joined Spurs, I was instantly made to feel that after Chelsea, I was no longer such a big fish.
It would be the first week that he came to the club from Chelsea back in 66, is that we had a very strenuous training session, and it was a completely different type of training to what Terry was used to at Chelsea. The game had gone on very, it was very competitive, and everything was flying around, and him and Dave Mackay were paired against each other. And Terry, for some unreason, went into a tackle with Dave, and all hell broke loose. It was a very, very tough introduction for Terry to Tottenham.
But it was an exceptional team, with outstanding individuals like Jimmy Greaves, Alan Gilzean, Dave Mackay, Alan Mullery, Mike England, and Pat Jennings, to name but a few. And that first full season, the Twin Towers of Wembley were beckoning to me at last. And who should our opponents be? Yes, you've guessed it. My old mates at Chelsea.
Robertson was perfect for the rebound. Again, and decisively as it turned out, the sheer class of Tottenham Hotspur showed itself. From Robertson's header, Frank Shaw shot into the net. To a very proud Dave Mackay, the Duke of Kent presented the trophy, which in the whole field of sport is surely the most coveted, the FA Cup.
Although I played for another three seasons at Spurs, that remained a highlight. I never really felt I got on as well as I did at Chelsea. And in 69, I went and crossed town to Loftus Road.
You see, in a football club can be run by a player, a manager, a coach, a director. There's one man, often in the club, who is the dominating character. When he was at Queen's Park Rangers, he was the overriding person. This is where he really became a player coach.
He was the type of person that actually took control on the field. And you looked to Terry for his experience. You looked to him to help you out in certain situations, whether it be me or a lot of the other young lads at that time that were in the side. And he became virtually a father figure to the team.
That QPR side was full of talent and top characters like Jerry Francis, Terry Mancini, Frank McClintock and Stan Bowles. Never a dull moment.
I met him in a hotel in Burnley. The first impression I got of him was that he was always very smart, smartly dressed. I just came down from up north, all like an old rag bag, and there was Mr. Venables with his blazer on. Which was, I'd never seen a blazer until that time, actually. We used to do coaching after training. Terry would take that, give up his time to coach players after training. I was in a rush to get to the betting shop, but even I stayed sometimes.
He's an extremely talented individual in many, many aspects. I think, I think he could achieve anything that he wanted to achieve if he applies himself, as he's always done in the past, to anything he wants to do.
I joined Queen's Park Rangers after I left Arsenal, 74, I think. And it finished up being four of the happiest years of my life. Terry and I and John Hollins and David Webb and all the different players at Queen's Park Rangers had sing songs after the game, and the team spirit was superb.
It was at this time I was elected onto the PFA, which gave me a chance to play Rumpole of the Bush.
It then got to the stage where people used to defend players when they came up for hearings of, with over their bookings or the sending offs, and Terry was one that sort of went on to that from a point of view that he really wanted to get involved with it, and he defended quite a few players, and I suppose there's a lot of players can look back and think, God, I wouldn't have played this week if it hadn't been for Terry Venables.
But in 1974, I moved south to Crystal Palace, and at last I joined up with Big Malcolm Allison.
Came and played for me, And after about eight games, I realised that playing in the third division and playing with the players that we had, you know, that he wasn't being able to give of his best. And also he'd lost a little bit of pace, and I thought it's the end of his career. You know. So I said to him, Terry, I want to see you. So he came up the office, and I'm sitting in the office. And, you know, you've got lots of things on your mind when you're a manager. And he came in, I said, sit down. I said, you're going to finish playing. I said, you're finished. I said, you're not going to play anymore. You're going to go work on the coaching side. You're going to work with me on the coaching side. He stood up. He went, I wouldn't accept that from anybody else, he said. He said, I'm not sure that I'm going to accept it for you. He said, but I wouldn't accept it from anybody else. He said, I might accept it from you, you know. I said, never mind about your might. You're finished. You stopped him playing. You're going to coach. So he's gone, walked across the office, and he got to the door, and he went, Happy New Year. It was New Year's Eve, and I forgot.
And here is Terry Venables' complete playing record. A total of 508 games, 50 goals, and holder of a unique record of being capped for England at full, under-23, youth, schoolboy, and amateur levels.
I've known him over 30 years now. And, you know, you meet people, and not very often you keep friendships that long. But that was the beginning of our great friendship at Crystal Palace.
Teaming up with Big Mal was nothing if not different. But soon I was wearing another hat. The cup run of the mid-70s, when we took the third division side to the semi-final, gave the club the appetite for success. And when Malcolm departed and I took over, I was manager of a league club for the first time.
Terry's character changed from being a player, then he went into management. It was more deep thinking. He thought about things, and he always had a picture of what he wanted in football and in life.
He had so much respect within the club, especially from the younger players, that when he took over as manager himself, it was very easy for us to sort of get on with him. He was quite a young guy, obviously, at the time himself, and he could relate to us very well. It was a very fun club. We were all buzzing, really. You know, we had a lot of success at youth team level, coming to reserves, success there, and then obviously getting promotion from third to second and second to first. It was tremendous.
We'd built a tremendous team. Like the Chelsea side of my youth days, it was based on young players and became dubbed the Team of the 80s as we made our way up to the First Division. No, I didn't then become the manager of the Royal Opera House. That might surprise you. But the boss at Covent Garden had a major hand in my next project.
Thinking back, what I loved about Hazel, really, was the tone of voice. I mean, sort of streetwise, cheerful, knowing your way around, as good, thinking yourself as good as the next man. I put a lot of that down to Terry Venables. I mean, I admired the other writer, Gordon Williams, but the sense of London in Hazel came from Terry, the sense that skill would get you a long way and you needn't really be put down by anybody.
But it wasn't in the cosy confines of Covent Garden we wrote Hazel, no, but in shady Soho.
He would drive from Loughton to Ruislip, the Rangers training ground, Queen's Park Rangers, do his training, then drive to Soho and tootle round Soho Square endlessly until he got a parking spot, which is quite hard. And dodging tube fares would be one thing, but feeding pennies into the meters instead of silver coinage would be automatic for your average East End. So one day in Soho Square, he put in the 2p, and it jammed on the meter. So he got his Yale key, which was attached by some fantastic means to his trouser waist, on a bunch. And he had to stretch his hip up a bit to get the chain to ram the coin in with a Yale key. And the Yale key went sliding in and got caught in the ratchets of the parking meter. And he's now trapped by the trousers with his right foot actually just off the ground, or he's on his toe. And he couldn't get it off. And there was only one way to get it off, would be to take his trousers off. But to get them off, he would have had to stand on his hands upside down because of the way this one. So I had to run to a phone and phone the traffic warden office, and finally got the head traffic warden on the phone, and he said, I said, my friend is stuck by the trousers in a meeting room show who's square. He said, I have never heard of this before. I don't know if this is regular, and we do not have any means of dealing with this. I said, his name happens to be Terry Venables. He said, I will set wheels in motion for Mr. Venables. I will be there in person. Tell him to hang on. I said, he can't go anywhere because his trousers are stuck. So the head warden came, and I thought, well, he's going to get done for this because he'll find the 2p in and the key. You see, not a bit of it. It's the footballer can call his own shots in London among us ordinary people.
This was the first fruit of our labours. They used to play on grass. A soccer novel set in the future. It still seems ahead of its time, really, with plastic pitches and a British Cup tournament, and all written in 1971. But then came...
Tracking down the Avery family was like a trip down memory lane. A warm July evening in the east end of London town.
And I thought, Hazel. Well, if you said that, you could have a lot of jokes. Cockney saying, oh, your name Hazel. And he's, oh, is that a girl's name? Yeah. He says, whack. He whacks you right in the face.
Now, this is the real James Hazel. Jimmy Hazel, our centre half in the Lymington School Board team, and a very good player. The real names of the authors of Hazel were changed. And it wasn't necessarily to protect the innocent.
The reason we called them PBU was that they'd be reviewed without anybody knowing who'd written them. They used to play in Gascot, reviewed by sports reporters on sports pages and things, you see. So we thought of PBU, which was the name of an old uncle of mine in Aberdeenshire, I heard him claiming that it was his uncle, but he was a bit like that.
Now, Hazel topped the ratings in Britain and even did well in Spain, where L. James became top of the bestsellers.
And I was thinking, sitting in the crowd at Barcelona in the stand with 100,000 people there, the sunshine, this tremendous architecture, the sunshine, the flags, the crisp flags, the incredible, and the team comes out. And I thought, well, Tell, looking down at me, I thought, well, Tell, if you'd played your cards right, you could be sitting in a sweaty room of me smoking somewhere in Seoul, getting the carbons in the right way round, and, you know, haggling with some bloody publisher over 750 quid.
But Spain was still in the future, and in 1980, Alan and I made the decision to renew our acquaintance with an old friend, Jim Gregory, and QPR.
He got on with the job extremely quickly. We were fifth off bottom, second division when he joined. And we went to a run of 12 games, 12 wins and 13 matches, and only narrowly missed out on promotion.
And it was in the Cup that once again we were able to make an early impact.
Only two or three days before the actual kick-off, we decided to play with the sweeper system. And great surprise to the players, but Terry obviously knew how we wanted to play the game. And on the day, it worked fantastically well. We came off winning 1-0. And at that time, West Brom were a very strong side. I felt as though that Terry, just with that one change, had changed the whole thing in our favour.
Walking out in front of your team at the Cup final has got to be a highlight of any manager's career. It was a fantastic occasion. The fact that we were second division underdogs against the mighty Spurs, well, that didn't make losing any easier. Especially as many rated us the better side in the replay. The following year, our disappointment was made up for with promotion to the first division. And the following year, we finished fifth in the first division and qualified for Europe. But so did I. The success of the team, coupled with the fact that I was managing director of QPR, meant that I was a hair's breadth away from my ambition to both own and manage a football club. And then I got the call from Spain.
Well, he put his arm around my shoulders, tears come down his face. And But you say, I'm going. I've made up my mind. I'm going. And basically, it had to be very sad because I could see so many places further we could go with Terry, and that's why I felt at the time I wanted him to buy the club.
Barcelona is undoubtedly one of the most beautiful and cultural of cities. It makes Bognor look like, well, Bognor. But don't let appearances deceive. The Catalan people are the most fervent football supporters, probably in the world. Their dreams are centered around the stadium, yeah, the Camp Nou. I'll never forget it. Where during the Civil War, it was the only place that they were allowed to speak their own language, Catalan. Football represents far more than just a game.
They was obsessed by it. And you do feel that, yes. But we understood the problem because they hadn't won in 11 years. They've not won the league. They had all these famous managers and coaches and they hadn't won the league in 11 years. And that's all the public wanted was you to win the league. So we knew what to expect. We knew that any stage they could sack you. We knew all that before we took it. So when we took... We said, we took the job. It's no good saying, oh, we didn't know that would happen. We knew that you were at the biggest, possibly the biggest club in the world, and we understood completely what the expectations were.
The first main decision came when Maradona left, and we had to replace him. I chose Steve Archibald, and a win at Real Madrid in our first game soon meant we had the supporters well and truly behind us. The first season just could not have gone better. We had won the title with games in hand.
If you said to me what really sticks in your mind more than anything in Barcelona was coming back with the championship. But I never ever envisaged there'd be a million people. And there was a million people from the airport to try and get us back to the football ground and on the way to go to a civic reception. That journey took 7 hours and it was unbelievable. We got back to the ground about 12 o'clock at night and there were still 100,000 people waiting to see us into the stadium, go onto the pitch, wave to the crowd.
People were showing them crosses, an old lady kneeling in a black Spanish lace, raising a crucifix to him on top of the bus. If the King and Terry had walked in a room, there was no doubt in Barcelona as to which would have been the star.
The trouble with winning is that people expect more of the winning, and then more still.
And we could feel the public changing. We'd given what they wanted, which was the league. Now they wanted the European Cup. To try to get you a picture of where there's pressure all the time. We got beat in the European Cup in a shootout, a penalty shootout, after extra time. We'd lost 1-0 in the Spanish Cup. We'd come second in the league, and we won the League Cup. And a lot of people in Barcelona saying we had a poor season.
The third season began brightly. We bought Gary Lineker, and in his first game against Real Madrid, repaid most of the fee.
Not only did he impress as a coach, but also as a person, he was sort of went out of his way to talk to players to make them feel comfortable. But not just myself, but even the Spanish players as well. He's the sort of manager that likes a good relationship with people. He doesn't like just being the boss and everybody sort of sergeant major type. He likes to be involved with the players and to be friendly with them.
But despite Gary's goals, the team perhaps didn't do as well as hoped. We came second, but second in a country like that is not good enough. So in the first three seasons, we were first, second, and second. European Cup finalists, and also picked up the Spanish Cup. Let's be fair, I think that's not bad by any standards.
And then we started into the fourth season. The first five games, I think we just won one game. We really splattered and we weren't playing well. And I remember there's a thing they have in Spain, if you're not doing well, out come all the handkerchiefs and they all wave to the president, which basically they're trying to say the president should go. And the president's not going to go, so the scapegoat is going to be the coaching staff. And I remember the first goal gone into Valencia and all the handkerchiefs come out. I remember saying to Terry, I think we should book our tickets because we're on our way out, because you could see the handkerchiefs were coming out and you knew then the writing was on the wall.
I think Terry's pretty good at hiding his real feelings, but I know that he was disappointed after having been such a success there in his first year, and being so close to being the most successful Barcelona manager ever in the second year when they were unfortunate to lose on penalties in the final of the European Cup.
No es bueno para nadie. Yo creo este es el problema. Si ellos dicen hasta Navidad o...
I was with him just afterwards and you could see that he was a little upset, but he does hide things well.
But even though the job in Barcelona prep turned a little sour in the end, I still find it very hard to knock the lifestyle or the people. And they did give me a chance to sing. Now careful, stay tuned.
I've got you under my skin. I've got you deep in the heart of me. So deep in my heart, you're really a part of me. I've got you under my skin. I try so not to give in. I said to myself, this affair I never should go so well. But why should I try to resist when, honey, I know damn well that I've got you under my skin. I'd sacrifice anything, come what might, for the sake of having you near, in spite of a warning voice comes in the night and it repeats, yes, in my ear. Don't you know, you fool, he ain't gonna win. Use your mentality, wake up to reality. For each time I do, the thought of you makes me stop before I begin. Cause I've got you under my skin. I'd sacrifice anything, come what might, for the sake of having you near. In spite of a warning voice comes in the night, repeats it, yells in my ear. Don't you know, you fool, he ain't gonna win. Use your mentality, wake up to reality. For each time I do, the thought of you makes me stop before I begin. And I got you under my skin. And I like you under my skin.
So that nearly brings us up to date. It's recent history now that Spurs called me while I was away in Florida. And before you could have said, Chris Waddle, here I am back at White Hart Lane. Call me a mad sentimental fool if you like, but it is a bit like coming home. You could say this job, like Ron Greenwood used to say, is perhaps a little crazy, doing too many things. It's like a circle of pressure around you, and the things you have to do, as he said, there's too many. You're responsible for training, to the directors, to your players, to your own staff, dealing in the transfer market, youth policy, mums and dads, press and the media. And these days it's getting worse. But all that work that you get involved with, you really like to perhaps clear that all out of the way, because the one thing that I've always enjoyed, and sometimes you can't get to, is training with the players. It's the coaching and the functional work for the team, the typical pattern of play. And also, talking to players individually is important. I think that you can talk to a group of players to get the message across, individual problems or areas that perhaps players don't like talking amongst other people. I find that they will say more on their own than they will in groups.
He can handle, I reckon he could handle any player in the world, full stop, at anything. He, you know, he's got so many, he look at a corner, he's got about eight or nine ideas in a corner. Other things, his tactics are just unbelievable. And I think managers who are wanting to learn, he's the manager they should come and watch him.
And then, of course, we have the press. Well, they've got their jobs to do, we've got our jobs to do, and sometimes they're not the same. It's been a busy week this week, but it's great to see my daughters, Tracy and Nancy. And, of course, this little champion, Sam. My grandson. Some say he looks like his dad, others say his mum. But I think he looks like Sam. I'm not really a one to hang around in the office and hope for things to happen. I like to go out there, have business meetings, meet people and try to make things happen. Today, I'm meeting Adam Faith, not only a very good friend of mine for many years, but also a big football supporter too.
On a personal level, he's very kind, very loyal, very genuine, honest sort of man, and a very, very good friend to have. On a business level, I think that Venners is probably, of all the people I've met in sport, and football in particular, he is the one that is the businessman. And he could be chief executive of any major corporation. If anybody is going to turn football into a corporation, Venners is going to be the one to do it.
When it comes to meetings, I don't believe in finishing at a certain time. Who knows, the next meeting might be the real one that makes some progress. So you could finish at any time. On this occasion, I'm meeting somebody you've already met yourself. The monster agent, Eric Hall. Now, as if that's not enough, this is my latest pet project, the board game. I've always enjoyed playing board games. I never really felt I've enjoyed one with enough imagination, especially in the sporting world. So, me and a friend, Paul Revere, have been working hard in the evenings on this particular board game about being a manager. Well, here's your chance. You are the manager. The match day. Now that's what it's all been about. Not quite nervous, but that uneasy feeling that I think if you'd left the game, that's what you'd miss. But not being sure.
Well done!
Come on, Johnny! In! And again!
Oh, you... Be alert! Be alert! Hello!
Watch your face! You're a cheat, not a cheat! You get away with murder!
Now listen, lads, half time, I don't like saying good things too early, but if we can reproduce that, what we've just done again, we're in a chance to win this game. You do yourself such a favour, you know yourself that we can deal with it. Now listen, come on, I mean, let's do yourself a favour. We've let ourselves down badly recently. It's a great chance for you to do something with these. Just don't overthrow when they hit us on the break. 45 minutes we've got to do it again, and we could get a big reward tonight for this. Mabs, the midfield doing a great job. Keep encouraging, you're doing a great job. Keep it up, keep working. I tell you what, you get in on these free kicks, if you get a good delivery, you'll score ahead of there. Come on, we ain't nothing. Anything less, we get nothing. Anything less, we get nothing. So, you know what they're like? Come on, whatever, let's have a winning attitude. Let's have a winning attitude, not just making a good game of it.
Let's go.
Come on. Get warmed up, Shuey. Best of luck, son. Try and make some runs behind him. Try again! Up you come, come on! Mitchell! Mitchell, look! In! Well done, son. Yes!
You know, like I said, every story should have a beginning, a middle, and an end. I think for the end, we'll have to wait a little bit longer. Anyway, there's always another chapter around the corner.
He's a very good friend, excellent friend. And I can't say more than that because there are very few.
I've always thought over the years, you know, trying to think up something bad to say about Terry, but I never could think of anything.
Terry Venables, for me, I think he's the brightest, the best coach, manager we've had in this country for a long time.
He's never lost for a word or a reply, and that would help him a great deal if he was a professional comedian. He'd always have an ad-lib. And of his qualities, he's a very loyal friend. And I think loyalty is most important in life. And I'm very pleased to be a pal of his. I enjoy his company very much.
Very proud of him. I don't know if I can say any more. Very, very proud of him.